Well, hello. How's everybody doing? David Vos here. It's a beautiful day in Oklahoma. The sun is out. It's been warm. Feels like spring is here. And I'm excited to enjoy this coming spring. Got lots of things I want to do. Been working on my pond and making it bigger. And it's just an amazing and exciting thing to see the sun start to come out. And well, today I want to do a video about the end times, the apocalypse. That's an exciting subject. And I don't even know where to begin, but as most of you know, I was born and raised a Jehovah's Witness. Jehovah's Witnesses have some peculiar ideas. I was thrown out kicking and screaming when I was 18 years old. And I guarantee that was quite a while ago. So I haven't even had any association with that group of people for many years. Now, I admit, for a few years after I was 18, I still had a lot of that thinking in my head. A person doesn't just escape scot-free from indoctrination. It takes time to overcome a lot of the prejudices. Obviously, I don't go by most of their main teachings today. I mean, Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe that Jesus was God. They believe he was an angel named Michael. They believe the end of this age began in 1914. They're the only faithful and wise servant. They still believe in all these principles of the law. They go around disfellowshipping and excommunicating people. We could go into so many different aspects of what they believe. They don't believe that you get that, you know, the New Testament's not even written to the people that live today, according to them. And I know a lot of ex-Jehovah's Witnesses and stuff probably would be flabbergasted to really even think about this, even though they would admit it once it was brought to their attention. They'd be like, well, I guess you're right. I guess that's what we believe. But they believe that only this little small group of individuals called the anointed are going to get saved and go to heaven. And everyone else, all of the billions, there's 7 billion people on this earth, and they only believe 144,000 are ever going to be saved. In all of the history of mankind, from Adam to down to the last day. And they get immortality and go to heaven. No one else in human history gets immortality. Because they believe that God created the earth and created mortal individuals and never gave Adam and Eve immortality. Remember, they hadn't eaten of the tree of the life yet. So they say, well, they could have lived as long as God wanted. But they don't have immortality. And they don't believe that anyone has ever been offered immortality other than a select few. They call the remnant today. And I suppose just a few, couple of 3,000 or something that lives on the earth today that's doing the modern work of warning the world that the world's coming to an end and they're all going to be destroyed. They don't celebrate the memorial, as they call it, or the Passover, or communion, or mass, or whatever you want to call it. More or less, they do a black mass. Because they believe all of their followers, which is millions, cannot go to heaven and partake of that new covenant. They don't believe that covenant is for them. So they go and they observe it. And they pass around a glass of wine and some bread or some unleavened bread or something. But nobody eats it. They more or less mock it. Now, I don't suppose they think of it that way, but that's really what it is, because the Apostle Paul says, do ye this in remembrance of me. Or Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. And the Apostle Paul says, you know, that this is something we do often. As often as you drink it, you drink his blood. And this is the new covenant. So they don't partake of the new covenant, and they don't believe they're under the new covenant. Only Jesus and his little flock. They call it a little flock, which in the end is only going to be 144,000. Many of them have already been chosen from the days of Christ till now. And so at this present time, they don't believe that. So this is a very peculiar doctrine that most Jehovah's Witnesses don't even contemplate, really, even when they join. They just think, oh, okay, I guess I don't get immortality. I mean, that's just enough for them, you know. They're just glad to sit and watch and observe and just be grateful that that what they believe is that God's going to allow them to survive the coming Armageddon. They're not going to get into immortal life. They're going to just survive. And they'll be able to live on for possibly 1,000 years. And after that, there's Jehovah's Witnesses have never said that they could live forever beyond that. Because I think they've indicated that perhaps God in his mercy would let them live even longer than that. Or maybe one day, who knows, because, you know, God always changes his mind, I guess, according to them. One day, maybe he'd give them immortality too, if they're really, really obedient. But they believe that during 1,000 years, men will still be mortal. You'll live a lot longer, but you'll still be mortal. And at any time during 1,000 years, or even now, when you're a Jehovah's Witness, if you disobey the elders or do anything wrong, then, of course, that's it. You get thrown out, and you're going to die in Armageddon. Now, anytime during this millennium, that the great multitude that they don't believe is 7 billion people, but just like 10 million at the most. So there's going to be 10 million people on the earth, maybe a few million that are resurrected, altogether 15, 20 million at the very most, of human beings that are allowed to survive and go through this kingdom where they're going to be ruled over by the anointed Jesus and his apostles. We're going to sit on 12 thrones and rule over them, and they're going to be their subjects in this kingdom where they're going to be still mortal. They'll be given a life that won't end unless God chooses to end it. So they have to be obedient. They're still they don't receive immortality. They don't get the crown of life. Anyway, I don't really want to go into that anymore, because this video is not going to be at all about that. But I wanted to just let you guys understand that this is where I came out of. And obviously, I don't believe anything like that anymore. But what I want to do is explain to you a little bit more clearly the actual truth about the end days, the apocalypse, and what's going to happen. Because, believe it or not, there has been a lot of truth in the world for a long time that we have never been told. And it got distorted by individuals like Jehovah's Witnesses and Seventh-day Adventists. And that's where I'm going to show you the source of where Jehovah's Witnesses originally got their information, and then they distorted it, and it just kept getting worse and worse, and as time went on, they got more ignorant, forgetting where they got their sources, you know, scratching out things when it didn't happen according to what they thought would happen, and then they make up new stuff, and they got more and more ridiculous and more ridiculous. Same goes for the Seventh-day Adventists and the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, who have a lot of same kind of teachings. Not necessarily some of the crazy things that I was saying about Jehovah's Witnesses. I think that's peculiar to Jehovah's Witnesses, in a sense. Although Seventh-day Adventists believe similarly, but I think they have a little bit better doctrines. I mean, I think most Christians know that we're all Christians, and we're all under the new covenant, and we're hoping to have eternal life, immortal life. But what I want to discuss is, as you know, Jehovah's Witnesses have this thing where they believe that in 1914, that ushered in the last days. Now, you know, years ago, it almost made sense because they thought, well, that was World War I. And look at, the Bible says in the latter days, hard times hard to deal with shall be here. Men shall be lovers themselves and disobedient to parents, and all these terrible things are going to happen. It's like, well, yeah, look at the world in the last generation. Makes sense. World War I. Because, you know, Matthew chapter 24, it talks about when the disciples came up to Jesus and they asked him, when will be the end of the world? and the sign of thy coming. And Jesus said, nation shall rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There shall be earthquakes and pestilence and food shortages or famines in one place after another. And it talks about these signs. And then it talks about this great tribulation, which has never occurred before and will never occur again. And then they'll see the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. So they quote this and they say this all began with 1914, with World War I. Problem is at that time they actually believed that it would be a short tribulation of 3.5 years, and the whole thing would be over in 1918 or something like that. Well, when it didn't happen, and the world didn't end in 1914 or 1918 after the end of the supposed tribulation, they just made it up and said, well, we're waiting for the final end, and there's this and there's that, and there's another prophecy in Daniel. We're going to throw that one in there, and we'll lengthen it a little further. And what they never told their flock or their congregations was they was getting all of this was a rehash of things that had been going on for a long time. This came from the Advent movement. And originally they started this thing where they thought the world would come to an end in 1844. And when it didn't happen, they changed it to Jehovah's Witnesses started up after 1844. Charles Taze Russell came along like in 1864, something like that. So the Adventists had already gone through this 1844. It was originally called the Millerite movement. So this whole thing, supposedly, in the minds of Adventists and early Jehovah's Witnesses, they knew that all of this was originally started by William Miller, who began to teach that the world would end in 1844 by looking at the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation and other places and trying to figure out what it meant in Daniel, where it talked about the times and a half of times and the 1,260 days and all of these prophecies and how it related to the Matthew 24 that we talked about in the last days and the Great Tribulation. And they had determined that it would all end by 1844. And in those days, they had this belief that the 1,260 days of Daniel and Revelation were to be understood as years. And they started from the time of the little horn, they concluded, was somehow it was the Catholic Church or the Pope or something. And they had a view that it came up in around 630 or something, and it all ended around 1844. And they were waiting for the end of the world. When it didn't happen, the Millerites kind of disbanded. There were various groups. One group went off and kept pushing the date forward. Another group decided, I'm not going to make any more speculations. And they just kind of held to what they believed, but thought, well, God will reveal it in its due time. They didn't know what was going on. They just said, well, you know, it still made a lot of sense, but they couldn't figure it out. So groups came up, like a woman named Ellen White came along right about that time. And she decided, she believed she had had a vision. And God had told her that the problem was that the world wouldn't come to an end in 1844, see, but that just marked the time of his judgment and this executive judgment where God would begin to look down from his throne in heaven and gather people into the Advent movement. So it was a time of where these angels, the three angels in Revelation, would go forward and they would warn people, you know, get out of Babylon the Great, get out of Babylon the Great. And basically become Adventists, you know, and get the mark of the Holy Spirit, which they believed was to keep the Sabbath. And everybody who began to realize, see, that Ellen White was a great prophet, and 1844 had arrived by the prophet Miller, but he didn't quite understand it, see, but she did. She was a better prophet. And now they knew that the time of his executive judgment would begin, and people would have to start listening to this message of the three angels, which was warning them to, you know, start going by the Ten Commandments, worshiping the true God, and doing the certain teachings that she had that made them correct, and it would that by doing so they would be by keeping the commandments, they were basically getting the seal of God in their foreheads. And so more or less it was a work that was being done by the angels. And people were making decisions, and they thought that the world would come to an end at any minute once this gathering would be finished. And they used scriptures like the certain parables in the Bible about the 10 virgins. They said, oh, well, in 1844, 10 virgins went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 were foolish and 5 were wise. And the ones that were wise got oil in their lamps. So they said, oh, a bunch of the Millerites, they gave up, see. They didn't have any oil in their lamps, and they all left, and they quit the organization. But see, Ellen White was the last modern-day prophet to guide people into this truth. And so there are some of these Adventists that are wise, and they didn't give up. So they had other things like the faithful steward that would be there to feed the sheep at the proper time and give them spiritual wisdom. So she was that faithful steward, and these kind of teachings would get carried on with Jehovah's Witnesses later on. And they taught also about having your garments white, see, because we're going out to meet the bridegroom. So if you were not going to keep the Ten Commandments, then you had filthy garments, and you wouldn't be acceptable, and he would throw you out into the outer darkness that was going to come in the great conflagration, and all the saints or the saved or the Adventists that were separated from the wicked world, they would go up into heaven kind of in a rapture, and they would live 1,000 years with God in heaven. That's how they believed, how they reconciled the whole Old Testament, because they were worshiping the Old Testament commandments, and they talked about Yahweh. They went back to the old worship of Yahweh, Jehovah. They call it Jehovah. Went back to the Ten Commandments. Some of them even started keeping the holy days, and they had to keep their garments spotless and be perfect and listen to the three angels' message and the warning, because the times were this was the last days, see, and any minute God was going to come and bring the the fire upon the earth. It would burn up. The whole world would be in a conflagration of fire, and then all the wicked would perish. They didn't believe they would go to hell. The Adventists didn't believe that in life after death, neither did Jehovah's Witnesses. They thought that they believed in soul sleep. So they thought, well, once you died, that was it. God wasn't a cruel God. He didn't send people to be tortured into hell. But he just gave them everlasting destruction or death. And hell was simply symbolic of the pain and the suffering that people were going through. During this period from 1844 on, when they were sort of thrown out from the believers, and they didn't have this wonderful, refreshing water of truth, but they were suffering from their agony and living in this corrupt world, or they had, there was always these various different teachings, but they thought it was very symbolic. And so they taught their people, because they always, people would forget that these teachings were just rehashed. That Miller was teaching all of this before, then the Adventists did it, then there was another group of people, and then Jehovah's Witness came along and rehashed it all again. So Charles Taze Russell comes along. He says, well, he determined that 1844 was a time similar to what the Adventists believed, but that the final end would be in 1864. So he went proclaiming the truth of Christ's coming and Zion's watchtower and saying, oh, Christ is coming, and it's 1864. So the whole thing started over again. And a bunch of people flocked to Jehovah's Witnesses, and they thought the world would end. 1864 came, and nothing happened. So, in his great wisdom, Charles Taze Russell thought, oh, I made a little mistake. It's probably 1868. And this kept going on and on. And it was 1874, and then it was 1884, and it was 1888. They went to... it finally got down to 1913. And then they discovered, oh, they had made a scribal error or something. They had discovered that there was no year one. Or there was no year zero. So Christ wasn't born in the year zero, but in the year one. So they had 1 year to play with. So they said, oh, it's really 1914. So the world will come next year. Well, something very interesting happened in 1914. There was World War I. And boy, all the people, Jehovah's Witnesses, started growing because they'd be like, wow, Charles Taze Mussel must have been right. I mean, we've got the biggest war in human history. This must be Armageddon. And then they thought, well, maybe it's going to be the end isn't going to happen like in a minute. But this war will last several years, and then the whole world will end in conflagrations and fire from God to destroy the wicked. So they really started growing because of that. Well, of course, 1914 came and went. Then they decided the end would be 1915, because they said there was a scripture that said the tribulation would come and it would be cut short, or else all flesh, no flesh would be saved. So they say, oh, well, in God's mercy, he's going to cut it short to 1915, and it won't have to be 3.5 years of tribulation. So that way he can save some people, the little group that follow Charles Taze Russell, the Bible students. Well, it didn't happen in 1915. They kept moving it up. It went to 1915, 1916, 1918. Well, in 19, I don't know, I think it was like 1916 or 17, a couple of the members of the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society were jailed. I think they were only in jail for 2 or 3 months. So that was kind of hard for them to explain, because they were like, okay, if we're the anointed and we just said the world was going to come to an end, but it didn't, but instead we go to jail, how are we going to explain this to people? So they thought, never let a disaster or, something like this go to waste, right? We're going to act like this is prophesied. You know, they're persecuting us like Daniel in the lion's den or something. So what they did is they decided that this 1914 was not the end of the world, but it was the beginning of the tribulation. And that even though the governing body, or Charles Russell and the anointed or the remnant, as they called it, this little group or remnant of Christ's, elect, the little flock, they were put into jail. But it would be just a very short while, because they were being persecuted. And this proved that they were right, that they were from God, because like all the prophets, they had to be persecuted, of course. And so rather than making people think, oh, well, then they must be wrong, it made people think, well, they must be right then. The problem is that when 1918 came, 3.5 years later, the world kept on going, and eventually the war came to an end, and, it just looked like they were wrong. So they came up with the idea, they switched it around a little bit, and they said, well, what actually happened? See, people forget what is written years before, and they keep accepting these new ideas as though they're completely, never heard these ideas before, and not even realizing, a lot of them, that all this was done by William Miller, it was done by Ellen White, now it was being done by Charles Russell, and he had been wrong many times, clear back from 1864, here they were in 1918, and nothing happened. So they pushed it up to 1924. And they said that there would be a short little period of time, kind of like the Adventists did. They kind of used the same idea, that it was the time of Christ's kingdom came invisibly in the heavens. You see? And, the judgment shall start with the house of God. See? So, Because Charles Taze Russell had made a mistake in some of his writings, this is how they got around it. They had to be judged for that, so they had to go to jail. So the house, they had a scripture that says that the judgment will start with the house of God. So they thought, oh, wow, this makes sense. God's going to come and judge the world. But before he does that, he's going to judge his faithful remnant, because remember, they're going to go rule as gods alongside Christ and rule the world. So they've got to be judged and purified and made righteous. They got to be disciplined. So this little thing, they went to jail, was just a discipline. And when they when they got out, they declared that they'd never again make a mistake. That they were direct mouthpiece of God. They were the prophet of God on earth, the mouthpiece of God. And that they had paid for their sins, and that they'd come out of jail. And now woe to the earth, for the devil has come down to you having great anger in his wrath. And this would be the the culmination of the Great Tribulation, which they somehow said, well, it might not be 3.5 years. It might just be a symbol of a short time. They got around that somehow. They said the 3.5 years was just a period of time that there would be a world war and they would go to jail. And during this period of time, their literature was banned. So that was how they understood it. Basically, I mean, they had various views at different times. It's hard to really keep track of all these things. So, the year 1924 came, nothing happened. They moved it up to 1933, I believe. There was some various dates in there. At one point, they built this big mansion. See, remember, Charles Taze Russell died in 1916. So then, Judge Rutherford started. He was this judge that took over the organization. They had a civil lawsuit. Many of the original Jehovah's Witnesses quit because nothing happened. The world didn't come to an end. So they all left and they started basically another church, right? I mean, with some of the, there was a few of the original Witnesses that held on and went ahead and stayed with the organization. But a lot of them, thousands of them, just quit because this wasn't working. But Jehovah's Witnesses never told that. And if they are, they're just like, well, they were just not very faithful. And of course, you've got to be faithful to Jehovah. And though those people didn't lose, they're not going to get to go to heaven because they didn't believe. So, so Rutherford started the whole thing over again, because by that time, people they had forgotten about the 1864. They didn't tell them about William Miller. They didn't tell them that they came from Adventists. They always denied it. We're not from the Adventists. We don't know what you're talking about. Who's Ellen White? We don't know anything about that. William Miller, that was a guy that had some similar ideals, but that was a long time ago. And so it was always these lies upon lies and manipulation. So he started writing books as if it all started in 1914, all these theories. They forgot all about 1844 and 1864 and all the other stuff. And the new ones that were coming in never had any clue that this was just a big scam. A scam on top of a scam on top of a scam. And so, they built this big mansion. Cost, I guess, I don't know how many hundred thousands of dollars for this big mansion, which in those days was like millions, And they claimed that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was going to come back in a specific year. And I don't remember the exact year, if it was 1833 or 24, whatever it was, 1934 or something like that. Well, at this time, when they thought the world would come to an end, all the Jehovah's Witnesses, there weren't that many of them at the time. I mean, maybe, like today, there's like 10 million. And in those days, there was like maybe 20,000 of them all around the world or something. And most of them were just coal porters. In other words, they would pay them to go out and sell the magazine and so forth. But, they all gathered around this mansion and waited for the resurrection of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and it never happened. Now, you would think that the whole organization would have folded and it had been over by that time. Building this huge mansion, and it was all over the newspapers. They published millions of books and pamphlets and tracts and, said they were the only true church and God spoke through them and this was all going to happen. And once again, it all turned out to be lies. And this continued on and on and on until they did another one. They said the world would come to an end in 1875. And that was about the last time that they made an actual date. But at that point, they continued to do it in a more of a tricky manner. They'd say stuff like, that generation will not pass away that saw 1914. Well, that kind of leaves it open, because what does that mean? What is a generation? People, at first, up until the 40s and 50s, they said, generation was 40 years. As time went on, they were like, oh, no, there's a scripture in the Bible that says the generation is 70 or 80 years, if you're mighty. So, 70 or 80 if you're mighty, so it may be 80 years. Well, if you count 80 years, well, if you count 70 years from 1914, That comes out in 1985. So people thought, oh, maybe it'd be 85. Or 1995, you know, 80 years, if you're mighty. But when that all failed, they had some new idea, new revelation. They would call it New Light. And they said, well, what it really means is that there would still be people alive that were born and were maybe 20 years old in 1914. People that were 20 in 1914, because they had to be able to see and witness that, the coming, you know, 1914, which was the heralding of Christ's kingdom and his, you know, and his, and the bringing of the Jehovah's Witnesses to begin his embryo of his kingdom, right? So it was announcing Jehovah's kingdom. So if you were like 20 years old, there would still be a few of these remnant, these anointed ones that would still be on the earth. Problem is that as time went on, more and more people decided they were part of the remnant too. So the original 2,000 or 3,000 that were partaking of the emblems and thought they were immortal and they were the anointed, it just grew. Every year it got a little bigger. And like in the year 1975 or something around in there, there were still 8,000 of them in the earth. But they weren't 20 years old in 1914. Many of them were 40, 30 years old, 50 years old. So then they started discouraging anybody else from partaking because this wasn't working. See, they had to change their views. They were like, well, I don't get it. So maybe as long as there was somewhere in the world, there was an anointed one. But, you know, if somebody started partaking when they're 20 years old in the year 1980, that wouldn't work. So they couldn't forbid it. But they basically started saying, well, you must be mentally ill if you think you're one of the anointed. So they kind of frowned upon it. If somebody in the congregation decided that to start reaching out and grabbing the cup of wine and drinking it, they would like look at them and sort of embarrass them and take them behind the scenes in the back room and counsel them. Well, that's not, you know, you can't be one of the anointed. You're not one of the anointed. You're probably mentally ill. We better talk to you. And so they discouraged it a lot. However, it didn't work. People kept starting to, more and more people wanted to be one of the anointed and go to heaven and have immortality. So it got to be a big problem. I think today there's a lot more than 8,000. It just keeps growing of these ones that claim to be anointed. So they had to come up with another view. So what they did was they decided that somebody who was alive in 1914 would still be alive before the end came. Well, it's getting harder and harder for them to teach that, because if you were even let's say you were just born in the year 1914 and you were 100 years old in the year 2014, that means today, if you were just born in the year 1914, that means today you'd be like 106 years old. Now they could technically say, well, there's one person somewhere, but they're still alive, you know. But none of the Jehovah's Witnesses are still alive. None of those original anointed ones are still alive. And now there may be one Jehovah's Witness somewhere that had been alive in 1914, or maybe there's two or three of them. So they're still hanging on to that. What they've done then in the last few years is they've just stopped talking about it. And what they're going to do then, after they get it out of people's memories, they'll pretend they never said it. And they'll just start a new idea. And this just will go on and on. But here's the thing that I don't know if any of, you know, maybe some ex-Jehovah's Witnesses are familiar with some of the stuff I've been saying, and perhaps some of the Adventists, and some of these teachings are taught by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints as well. The basic view, other types of Adventist movements and stuff, Millerite, or, you know, there are like sacred names groups and stuff that believe some of this. But what most of you probably don't know, I'm sure just about none of you know, is where William Miller got the idea. He got the idea from a man named Isaac Newton. And they have distorted what Isaac Newton said very, very badly. However, they took what Isaac said, Isaac Newton, and they took the parts that they liked, used it for their own ends to try and deceive people into thinking the world was coming to an end today, and got, they used his interpretation of Daniel and Revelation, because Sir Isaac Newton taught that the 1,290 days of the book of Daniel would start in the year 609. And I'm not going to get into all the dates because it would take hours to go into all the reasons that Sir Isaac Newton came up with all of these calculations. Remember, he created calculus. He's the greatest scientist that ever lived. He taught, he's the reason today we understand physics and everything that happens in the world of physics and science today is built upon Sir Isaac Newton. He was a complete and utter genius. In the days of William Miller and the Advent movement, they used to have charts where they would depict all the prophets from Daniel all the way to the present day. Well, not to the present day, because this was done like 100 years ago. Probably up to William Miller or whatever. And somewhere in the middle of the chart, they had this man holding a torch, and that was Sir Isaac Newton. See, originally, Sir Isaac Newton was central to their views. They based it on him and science. It was a true teaching. But when Sir Isaac Newton explained all of these things, he did so in such a way. I mean, this man was brilliant, understood just about, you know, what they don't tell you is Sir Isaac Newton studied ancient esoteric wisdom. As we've talked about in many of my videos, he translated the book, The Emerald Tablets, and all of these ancient esoteric sources, Kabbalah, and Egyptian writings, and so forth. More like a syncretist, and gathering all the information from all the ancient religions, and the Magi, and the Gnostics. And remember, he Sir Isaac Newton is back in the 1700s, and I think he did this in around 1700, in the early 1700s is when he wrote this. He did not teach that the world would come to an end in 1844 or 1914 or any of these other dates. He never taught the world would ever come to an end. Sir Isaac Newton did, however, teach that the end of this present age would end in the year 2060. We're not even there yet. He understood the 1,260 days of Revelation and Daniel to be a day for a year, like the other Adventists believe, but he started it from the birth of the Holy Roman Empire in 800 AD. So 1,260 and 800 gives you the year 2,060. But he didn't believe that would be the end of the world. And in fact, I believe he was probably correct. As you guys probably know, many of you have followed my videos, and I've been, you know, talking about a lot of this stuff in many of my videos. And I've said that all of these numbers in the book of Daniel and Revelation have to do with the astrological ages. I don't know that Sir Isaac Newton fully grasped all of it. No one grasps all of it. But I believe he's correct. I believe it all works out. Get these numbers as a day for a year. You can take it as a day for a year. There are multiple layers of understanding in the Bible. There's spiritual and symbolic understandings and literal understandings and various ways to understand the scriptures, because it's a masterpiece. It's inspired of God. And so, the basic, simple way, I mean, if you read Sir Isaac Newton's writings, they're vast. Remember, he understood calculus. He invented it. So he had all these writings and calculations. And it's he studied history. He's the one, I mean, you see Mary Baker, Ellen White, she had these huge books that she wrote. It's now been proven that she plagiarized most of it. Most of what she got from William Miller and Sir Isaac Newton. But I don't even know if she got it from Sir Isaac Newton or if it's just completely from William Miller. But it was more or less taking the words of William Miller and rearranging it because years had gone by and things didn't work out. So she just switched a few things. That was their little game that they played. Jehovah's Witnesses, when they came along, probably didn't realize that all of this was originally given to the world by the great genius and prophet, Sir Isaac Newton. By that time, they had distorted the entire work and all of it, his calculations, and they completely misunderstood it. So I see that we're getting down to like 40 minutes or something like that, and I'm not going to be able to go into it deeply as I thought I would. I wanted to explain in great depth how Sir Isaac Newton understood all these things. I've got a few minutes left. Don't worry. We're not leaving yet. But I want to kind of, at this point in the video, I want to start explaining the reality, how you're actually supposed to understand the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel, how Sir Isaac Newton understood it. But as many of you know, I have said that I believe that Christ's reign will begin in the year 2100. How does that fit with the year 2060? Well, remember, when Jesus was on the earth, he said, of that generation will not pass away. And I believe, you know, I know, I understand. Witnesses did this too back in 1914. Adventists tried this. But it's the truth. A generation is actually 40 years. And we know this because when Jesus stood on the earth in 33 AD, and said, this generation will not pass away before all things are fulfilled. It all came to one fulfillment in 70 AD with the destruction of Jerusalem by Antiochus, or by Vespasian, Titus Vespasian, who came in and destroyed Jerusalem. And not one stone was left upon a stone, according to the prophecy. See, so from when Jesus was baptized at 30, and then he went preaching. In that year, he began to preach this. And he said, this generation will not pass. That gives you 40 years to the year 70. So we know that it's that last generation will be 40 years. But we also know, and I can't get into it because there's a lot that we can, you know, we'd have to get into explain all of this. But there's various ages and each one ends and overlaps. So there's a 40-year period of overlap for each of these astrological aeons or ages. So, Jesus came and arrived as the king of this coming age that we've been going through, the 2,000 years we've been going through. And the full end, even though Jesus was crucified, after he passed away, they went through this last generation. And in their days, there were wars and rumors of wars and pestilences and things. And then there was this great tribulation that lasted for three and a half years, from 66 AD to 70, and that's how it was understood. However, the book of Revelation says there's another fulfillment, because the book of John was written in 100 AD, and John seems to indicate that there are several more different ways to understand it. One is a spiritual understanding, and one is a way to understand the entire thing all over again at the next coming of the next age. And so that would mean that we're about to go into the age of Taurus. Now, I know that probably throws up a red flag for a lot of people. If you've never seen a lot of my videos, you probably think, what are you talking about? Aren't we going into the age of Aquarius, Dave? No, we're going into the age of Taurus. The world, this new age movement that's been financed by the Rothschilds, disinformation, the financial with Witnesses and Adventists and Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints and the Unification Church and all these, you know, L. Ron Hubbard and Scientology and everything else they financed to make Babylon. See, we've got to get out of Babylon. So in a sense, when the book of Revelation says get out of Babylon, saying stop with the confusion, stop with all of this, let's go back to the truth, what Jesus actually said. And so Babylon then is the world we live in with all this confusion, this system. But Babylon is this government that's got 7 heads and 10 horns. So the 7 means successive, you know, like the days of the week, they follow in a cycle. And then the end of the cycle is rest. So 7 has to do with time. Each head rises. 5 have fallen. 1 is, the other is yet to come. And the last beast is a beast which these 10 horns give their power unto the beast, who is the eighth head, but of the seven. Now, Sir Isaac Newton had originally gone through all of this, and all of this type of understanding and the day for the year and stuff was taken over into Millerism, and they thought Newton was a prophet. Like I said, they had a chart with him in the middle holding the torch. When it failed to come in 1844, because Miller, when he looked at Newton's understanding of everything, he decided that he knew better than the prophets. He knew better than Newton, who had access to this ancient esoteric wisdom. By the time Miller came along, they had divorced themselves. All of these Christians were involved in this Protestantism and in this Babylonism, and they had no longer were able to understand that these ancient esoteric teachings were the true teachings. That they were that we're not supposed to worship the Old Testament God. So the esoteric wisdom had been lost. And so they looked at Sir Isaac Newton's understanding of the 1,290 days in the book of Daniel, which started in 609 and ended in 1899, which Newton said would be the beginning of Zionism, when people would start getting it back into their minds to go back to Israel. And in fact, it actually occurred, because that was the very year that Zionism occurred, and Jews from around the world met in Europe and discussed their plans to begin going back to the land of Palestine. And this Zionism and its movement began in that year. And then Newton said there would be 1,330 in 5 days. So that would be another 45 years. And that ended in 1944. And he said at that time, Israel would go back to their land. I'll be darned if that didn't actually happen, because in 1944, that was the end of the war, which was the thing that precipitated the Jews going back to their land. And the 1947, with the Balfour Declaration, right on schedule with what Newton said, he said that there would be a foreign government, which happened to be Britain, that would make a declaration for the people to return. And it happened. The difference is, he understood the 1,260 days to begin in the year 800, and that would end in the year 2060. Because that was such a far, you know, that date was so far ahead, you know, people in the days of 1844, they just couldn't imagine that the world would not come to an end in their day. I mean, 2060 just seemed ridiculous. They couldn't imagine it. So they just, the great prophet Newton must have been wrong. So they just scratched that out. And, you know, and as time went on, they even began to, you know, sort of hide the fact that all of their teachings were based on Sir Isaac Newton's calculations. They didn't even tell people that. And if they had, people would have gone back and looked at Newton's stuff, and they would have said, oh, wait, the world's not going to come in 1914 to an end, or 1944, or 1844, or any other date. But we've got a long time. It's actually going to just begin with the regathering of Israel. And they made, in 1948, they made themselves a nation. But yet, that's not going to be the end. Sir Isaac Newton didn't even believe that the world would end in 2060. Of course, there's going to be a millennium, right, after that. But he taught that that would just be more or less an end of that age, and then there were the beginning of a new. Remember, from 2060 then, there would be 40 years. It would, as Christ came in 30, and but the whole full end didn't happen until 70 of that last age. So the same would happen now. So I think that fits very well with the stuff that I've been saying. The world won't come, this old world won't fully come to an end until the year 2100. But a new age will begin. Sort of like the arrival of Christ, or the coming kingdom in the year 2060, which is only about 40 years from now. So this fits very well with what Newton was saying. It actually fits quite well with Nostradamus. and other people that we could go back in time and read their works. And so what Newton was saying then is that there would be, starting with Daniel, there would be this beast. It had four different beasts. And he understood, like the Adventists, that the ram and the leopard with four heads and stuff, he understood all that just like they do, with the Greek Empire being split up into four kingdoms. But it was not Ellen White that did all these historical calculations and figured out all these kings and how it would happen. It was Newton that put all of this history down, determined how the little horn would rise, which would be the Holy Roman Empire. I mean, there's beautiful things, proofs. When you look at Ellen, remember, Sir Isaac Newton's writings were hidden from the world for a long time. They were available to William Miller, but after that, somehow or another, they got locked up somewhere, and we didn't see those writings. They were completely hidden from the world until, I think, the year 1947, which is interesting because that's the same date the Nag Hammadi Library came to light, and we uncovered those ancient teachings of Jesus. And so I believe that's not some kind of coincidence, but that is, all of these ancient teachings are coming up out of the earth, and we're now having these amazing teachings arrive at this time in history so that we can really wrap our minds around what's really going on. And we begin to see how people of the past have distorted so much of what we've been told and lied to us. If William Miller had known that he got all this information, those individuals in his day, they knew it was coming from this esoteric believers like Newton. Remember, it's not just Newton. Copernicus and Galileo and Ptolemy and all these individuals were studies of the Kabbalah. But you see, then you come down to Jehovah's Witnesses and they say, oh man, you can't study the Kabbalah. That's all evil. That's the occult. Well, they couldn't tell you that it was coming from Newton, because then you'd have to admit that the occult was the truth. They stole things from the occult and cleverly, deceivingly, redid it all in some sort of guise of a modern Protestant kind of new religion called Jehovah's Witnesses or Adventists or something, all the while lying to you. Lying about where they got this information. Not wanting you to know. They would tell you that the Catholic Church murdered all the Christians. Never ever telling you that the Christians that they murdered were the occult believers, the esoteric believers, Freemasons, Gnostics, the Cathars. Ellen White, in her book, The Great Controversy, talks about the Cathars, but she never tells you that they're Gnostic, that they believe that Jehovah was the devil. But they just switched. They twisted it. And it wasn't by some coincidence or accident or a mistake, because they were being financed. As we've talked about, Jehovah's Witnesses, they got that big watchtower right down there in Brooklyn, right next to the UN building, financed by the Rothschilds. He knew Mr. Rothschild, Mr. Russell, shook hands with him, had a meeting with the Prime Minister of England. See, he believed in Zionism too. Remember, he was a Freemason. But at that time, Freemasons at that time, there was two groups. One who was trying to reveal the ancient mysteries that had been doing so for hundreds of years, and one group that wanted to keep it hidden. They wanted to veil it because they did not want the world to know what was about to happen upon this world. Because they had to hide things in order to, and deceive people in order to promote their connivory, their shenanigans. They had their own motives. They wanted to control us. They knew about these things that were happening and that were going to happen. Remember, the demons believe in Christ and they shudder out of fear. They know. Everybody that understands the ancient esoteric wisdom knows the truth. Anyone who's actually studied it, not just some, you know, bits and pieces of it. Those, not people who study, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses or Adventism, or if you really want to really do some research, don't study secondhand information that was designed to twist and to make, to confuse, to become Babylon. Don't study Babylon. Study the original prophets, the source of this esoteric wisdom. The interpreters of the ancient wisdom were those occult wizards, which means the wise ones, that the church killed and martyred. So we need to go back and understand that there is a break from Sir Isaac Newton in 1740, or whatever year it was, in that around 1720 or something, to 1844 and into the present day. All of this is the preparation that Satan was doing. That it says in the Bible that the bottomless pit would be open and he would come back out because they refused to receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. So therefore, he's going to send the strong delusion upon them. And this strong delusion was none other than the dark side of the occult that wanted to hide it, that like Aleister Crowley, who wanted to receive these great powers. Remember how Simon the Magus went to Peter and said, give me these powers and I may do what you do. He says, no, your heart's full of guile. You have no business in this. So Aleister Crowley couldn't get the power because it takes goodness and love and kindness, and he just couldn't get there that way. So he wanted to go the shortcut. He couldn't do it by being kind and loving. It takes a lot of, you know, self-control, which a lot of people just don't have. They get frustrated. So like Star Wars, you know, with the power, the dark side. They go to the dark side. And they use the dark forces. They know what they're doing. They know they're trying to defeat the good side. And this is what happened. Individuals who were actually Freemasons, as Charles Taze Russell was, he got deceived. And through his greed and selfishness and his lack of self-control, and his respect for the ancient truths, and probably for money, because he was a wealthy man, he financed that partly just to make money. He made a lot of money off the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. You know, all these Jehovah's Witnesses are running around handing out Bibles and tracts and all the money that they get from these magazines, they give it back to the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. And nobody knows where the money goes. Well, some of it goes back into building more factories, to build more pamphlets, to print more literature, so they make more money. They just keep making more money and more money and buying up real estate, mansions, and buildings all over the world, just as the Adventists and these temples you see with the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints being built, these magnificent temples all around the world, all their gold and their wealth that they're accumulating, and the control over the people by keeping them in the darkness and never telling them the truth. That's what's happening. So, I think I want to probably do another video on this. I don't know if I'll do it right away, but we'll, you know, these are some of the things that we'll be talking about in some of the upcoming videos. We want to cover a little more deep, a little deeper, how Newton actually understood prophecy and what he believed was going to happen. And how he understood all these different beasts in Daniel and the book of Revelation, as well as the spiritual understanding that he grasped coming from the occult wisdom. So we'll go ahead and do that tomorrow. We'll get back to you on that. This is David Vos. We'll see you guys again tomorrow. Have a good one.